Okay, sir. Okay, sir. I'm going to make a presentation. I'm Dr. Palash Kumar Saneri.
I think, is there a network issue at his end?
Dr. Palash, we can't hear you.
Can you hear me now?
Yes, but not yet clear.
Okay. So this is a paper on the oral health complications in patient diabetes attending a secondary care hospital in Puducherry. And this is a 5-year cross-sectional observational study. Oral health remains an ignored aspect of diabetes care. And as we all know that in various studies, complications related to oral health are more among the diabetics compared to the non-diabetics. Diabetics are more prone to develop periodontitis, gingivitis, early loss of attachment of tooth, loss of tooth at an early age, and abscesses related to gums and the dental caries, etc. It has been proven by several studies that hyperglycemia, it worsens the prevalence of the oral health, and poor oral health worsens glycemic control. So they together make a vicious circle, complicating each other. So it becomes imperative to break this vicious circle to improve the glycemic outcome and overall prognosis in diabetes. The aims and objectives of this study were to estimate the prevalence of complications related to oral health among the diabetics and determine the association of various oral complications of diabetes with patients with diabetes vis-a-vis non-diabetes. Study design was a cross-sectional observation study at ESI Hospital in Pondicherry. Patients who attended the dental OPD of ESI Hospital and were thoroughly examined by the chief dental surgeon. This included both diabetics and non-diabetics. Patients who had incomplete oral health records were excluded. The period of study was from January 2013 to December 2017. Clinical records of the patients were written in the dental OPD as per the prescribed format. They were initially entered in Excel and later statistically analyzed using Python software. Percentages were calculated for individual calculation complications. Binomial logistic regression was used to determine the association between diabetes and various complications. For the outcome variables, some working definitions were given. So, for instance, gingivitis, which is considered as an inflammation gums, clinically manifested by swollen gums, bright red or purple in color, tender to touch, bleed due to brushing. Periodontitis, inflammatory disease of supporting tissues of teeth caused by specific microorganisms or groups of specific microorganisms, resulting in progressive destruction of the periodontal ligament and alveolar bone with periodontal pocket formation, gingival recession, or both. Calculus was defined as a hardened dental plaque caused by precipitation of minerals from saliva and gingival fluid in plaque on the teeth. Stain as a tooth discoloration leading to abnormalities in tooth hue, color, and transparency. Caries was decay of tooth caused by acids made by bacteria. Gingival recession defined as exposure of the roots of the teeth caused by loss of gum tissue and or retraction of the gingival margin from the crown of the teeth. Missing tooth defined as absence of tooth due to extraction or any other reason. And periodontal abscess, localized collection of pus, that is an abscess within the tissues of the periodontium. These are some of the pictures just to illustrate the different types of complications which was seen. And these are all taken from, the photographs were taken from our patients with their permission. So on top left, this is chronic gingivitis. Next, to adjacent to it is a photograph of the dental abrasion. So, second, in the left, in the middle, these are the plaque and calculi. And then on the right of it, there is a gingival abscess. And then at the bottom, there is a gingivitis with recession of tooth. Now we come to the results. During this period, total number of patients that were studied were 2,156, 1,135 males, and 1,021 were females, out of which 571 patients were patients with diabetes. This is a box plot showing, these are different box plots showing the different complications. So these are histograms where if you notice carefully, so the different variables, now GAP is generalized adult periodontitis. Next to it's the adhesion. These complications were not very frequent, but the one complications on the right side, which like diabetes, variable with respect to diabetes, we have seen that dental caries, calculus, and stain were found to be more prevalent. And similarly, gingival abscess on the right side. Coming to the oral health complications of non-diabetics, dental caries was observed in as many as 56% of patients. Calculus was seen in as many as 55% almost. Stain was seen in 56%. Generalized adult periodontitis in 70%. Adhesion in 92%. Abrasion 89%. Gingivitis was seen in 45% of patients. Alveolar periodontal abscess around 95%. Missing tooth in 67%. Recession in 98% and mobile teeth in almost in 93% of the patients who were studied. Compare that with the diabetics, we saw a higher percentage of dental caries. Then calculus was seen in around 14%. Generalized adult periodontitis around 17%. And other complications like incision, abrasion were seen, missing teeth in around 5 of the patients, and recession was seen in less number of patients.
Yes, Dr. Palash, you have just half a minute left.
Okay. So implications, diabetes, non-diabetics, you can see this clearly shows the blue dots represent complications in diabetic patients, and as can be established that these are more commonly seen, the complications were seen in more commonly in the diabetes patients. Now, the ones in this slide, the one variables which have been labeled with red color, they represent the significant association with that. Dental caries, calculus, adhesion, abrasion, gingivitis, and missing teeth. These were more commonly seen in these are more significantly associated with diabetes. Furthermore, to establish the sensitivity and specificity of the model can be regarded as a good.
So you can sum up now. Your time is over.
So in our study, we found the dental caries is significant for people less than 240. Calculus gingivitis is significant for all age groups, and stain was significant for people with age greater than or equal to 38. Adhesion and gingival recession were significant in the compared to year age groups. Overall complications related to oral health were more commonly seen in the diabetes group of the patients. So dental missing plus gingivitis, adhesion, etc. were more common. Patients in missing age was treated independently as a variable, and then we can conclude that the patients with diabetes are more susceptible to develop oral health complications, and therefore it is our we recommend that oral health evaluation must be included as a standard part in diabetes management.
Yes, thank you, a very nice study, a huge one, more than 2000 patients you enrolled, more than 500 diabetic patients. I think it speaks of the volume. Dr. Bhagirath, you want to have any questions?
Yes, Dr. Sanyal, is it a cause or effect? What do you think?
Actually, this is a cross-sectional observational study, so it is very difficult to establish, because in order to establish a cause and effect, my idea, we need to have a sort of a case-control study where we could have studied these things. And because one important variable, age was associated with itself is an independent variable associated with these complications. So it is a bit difficult to establish. But if you compare if you see the complications graph, so obviously the diabetic patients had more number of these complications, and they were significantly associated complications, as we had studied using the binomial logistic regression model. So In my knowledge, definitely diabetes is associated with this. And some of these patients actually, this is actually, sir, it is an ongoing study also. We are following up these patients later also. I could not present the data due to shortage of time. So we have noticed wherever we have achieved a better oral health care,
Yes. Dr. Palash, could you find any correlation with HbA1c or the gender regarding the periodontal complications of diabetes? Any gender differences?
Actually, sir, we were not able to do HbA1c in our center because we don't have a machine, but we had been using the standard, fasting and PP sugar, and majority of these patients are the patients that already have diabetes for a long, long time. So, that is the HbA1c we were not able to establish, but gender-wise, we did not find any significant difference, sir.
Okay, and one final question from me. What is the significance as far as the metabolic health is concerned regarding this periodontal complication? We know that it is one of the most important or the sixth vital complication of diabetes. Any other significance other than the local problem?
Several studies have demonstrated that the cardiovascular risk complications.
Yes, okay, that's great. Great. Good. Bhagirath, you want to have any question?
No, sir. We sum up and go to the next candidate. Please, sir, carry on to next candidate.
So, a very nice presentation, Dr. Sanyal. Very important to periodontal health or perioral health is a very important marker, not only from the local point of view, but also from the cardiovascular point of view, which you rightly answered in your final question. We'll move to Dr. Pradeep Kumar, and he'll be speaking on diabetes and COVID-associated mucormycosis, a cross-sectional study. Again, my request to all the speakers, please stick to the time because that also is a part of your evaluation. You have to finish within the stipulated time and that will give you an additional bonus. So I would request now Dr. Pradeep Kumar to start his presentation. Your time will start once you start sharing your screen. Dr. Pradeep Kumar.
Sir, I think some technical error from Dr. Sanyal's side.
So can we move on to Dr. Himanshu Tripathi before, by the time Dr. Pradeep Kumar can correct his network problem?
Yes, sir.
So Dr. Himanshu Tripathi, and he'll be speaking on effects of oral zinc on glycemic status.
Yeah, myself, doctor. Excuse me, myself, Dr. Pradeep Kumar. I'm ready now. I will share the video.
All right, you can start.
Yeah. Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Dr. Kumar, please share your screen.
Just 1 second, sir. Yes, sir, it's visible now. The screen is visible now.
No, we cannot see your screen.
I've started the PowerPoint presentation, sir. Is it visible now?
No, not yet.
Share your PowerPoint presentation on Zoom.
Pankti, can you guide him so that?
Yes, sir, I'll guide him. Sir, please open your PowerPoint presentation first and then come to the Zoom. That is the green highlighted option of share screen. Select your PowerPoint presentation and just share it. Call Dr. Pradeep Kumar and guide him. Meanwhile, can we take Dr. Himanshu's presentation first?
All right. So, Dr. Pradeep Kumar, your presentation will be next. By the time you can fix your problem, do not worry. We'll start with Dr. Himanshu Tripathi. Dr. Himanshu, are you here? Yes.
Thank you, sir. Good morning to all of you, respected teachers and all the audience present here. I'm going to present my paper on effect of oral zinc on glycemic status in type 2 DM, type 2 diabetes mellitus. Introduction. There is a growing body of evidence in support of an association between hyperglycemia and zinc metabolism. Many studies have provided evidence that low zinc status is associated with impaired insulin secretion and decreased insulin sensitivity. Molecular and cellular studies in animal models have shown that zinc plays an important role in the synthesis, storage, and action of insulin under normal physiologic conditions. Zinc is essential for crystallization of insulin in hexameric complexes and is co-secreted with insulin or exposure to high glucose. Zinc is considered important because it plays a major role in stabilization and synthesis of insulin, hexamer, and pancreatic hormones. Zinc may improve glycemic control in diabetes mellitus and help in prevention of complications associated with diabetes. The aim of the study is to estimate serum zinc level at detection of type 2 diabetes mellitus. To study the effect of zinc supplementation on glycemic control as evaluated by fasting blood glucose, postprandial blood glucose, HbA1c and in newly detected type 2 diabetes mellitus patients. All the new patients attending the OPD and newly diagnosed diabetes mellitus were initially selected, and after getting consent regarding investigation and inclusion in the study, patients were subjected to fasting blood glucose and HbA1c. Selected patients were subjected to ultrasonogram abdomen to rule out chronic kidney disease, chronic liver disease, fundus examination to rule out diabetic retinopathy, and ECG, blood urea, serum creatinine, and urine routine examination, along with early morning urine microalbuminuria. After completing investigations, 112 patients were divided randomly into two groups. So each group consisted 56 patients. Patient group are assigned as 1 and 2. Each subject in group 2 was given zinc tablet 50 mg per day, and patient in group 1 were given placebo tablets along with the standard oral hypoglycemic agents available in the hospital. Subjects were asked not to change their routine activities and not to take any vitamin supplementation other than drug that was given. At the end of 6 months, during the study, serum level of fasting blood glucose, postprandial blood glucose, HbA1c, lipid profile, serum zinc levels, hemogram, urine analysis, and microalbuminuria and fundus examination were recorded. The sample size was 112 patients. 56 patients were divided in each group in the placebo and the control in the intervention group, and were given zinc tablet of 50 mg. in the treatment group one, which was placebo supplementation plus OHA in newly detected type 2 patient was given, and in the group 2, zinc was added along with the OHA. Inclusion criteria was newly detected type 2 DM without any complication, attending OPD. Exclusion criteria was type 1 diabetes, type 2 diabetes with complication, diabetes in pregnancy, chronic kidney disease, chronic liver disease, chronic pancreatitis or inflammatory bowel disease, subjects on zinc supplementation, immunomodulatory drugs, and chelating drugs. Results. In the study of 112 patients, serum zinc level in most of the subject in both group were below 75 microgram before zinc supplementation. And after zinc supplementation, serum zinc level were significantly increased. Mean serum zinc level in post-treatment placebo group is 70.8, and mean serum zinc level in post-treatment zinc group is 76.23. Comparison of mean serum zinc level pre-treatment in both the groups. In placebo group, out of 56 patients, the mean was 70.38. In the zinc group, it was 70.89. The standard deviation was 11.54, and the zinc group was 11.45. There was no significant difference at the start. After post-treatment, the mean serum zinc level in the placebo group was 70.8. with the standard deviation of 11.24, and the zinc group was 76.23 with the standard deviation of 11.57. In fasting blood glucose per pre-treatment group in both the groups, in placebo group, there were 22 participants with fasting blood glucose between 101 to 140, and 34 participants more than 140. In the zinc group, there were 24 participants in 101 to 140 group and 32 participants in more than 140 group. Fasting blood glucose post-treatment in both the groups, there were 2 participants with having fasting blood glucose less than 2, whereas in the zinc group, it was 10 participants, which accounted for 17%. And in the placebo group, there were 25 members in 101 to 140 group, and there were 29 participants in 101 to 140 groups in the zinc group, and there were 29 participants having more than 140 in the placebo group, and there were 17 participants having fasting blood sugar more than 140 in the zinc group. In the fasting blood glucose in the pre-treatment, the placebo group was 152.9, and in the zinc group was 153. There was no significant difference before giving the intervention. Post-treatment, the fasting blood glucose mean was 142.3 in the placebo group, and in the zinc group it was 129.1. After zinc supplementation in newly detected type 2 diabetes patient, the fasting blood glucose level is reduced by 24 mg per deciliter in comparison with placebo, which reduced fasting blood sugar levels by 10.6 mg per dl with a p-value of 0.00078. Postprandial blood glucose in the pre-treatment group in both the groups was there were 9 participants having postprandial blood glucose less than 200 in placebo group and 5 in the zinc group. There were 40 participants between the range 201 to 300 in placebo groups and 38 participants in the zinc group, and 7 participants in the range 301 to 400 in the placebo group, and 13 participants in the zinc group. Post-treatment, there were 3 participants postprandial blood glucose less than 200 in the placebo group. In contrast to, there were 16 participants having blood glucose less than 200 in the zinc group. There were 51 participants between 201 to 300 days in the placebo group. There were 38 participants in the zinc group. And in the placebo group, there were only 2 participants having blood glucose more than 300 to 400. And there were 2 participants in the zinc group also. Comparison of mean postprandial pre-treatment in both. The mean postprandial blood glucose in both the groups was 264.2 for the placebo group and 266.18 for the zinc group. Post-treatment, the mean was 246.21 in the placebo group and 218.36 in the zinc group. The postprandial blood glucose level reduced by 48 mg per dl in the zinc supplementation in comparison with placebo, which reduced postprandial blood sugars by 18 mg per dl. We conducted HbA1c in the pre-group. There were no significant difference in the starting. After treatment, the mean in pre-treatment group, HbA1c was 7.6 in the placebo group, and mean for zinc group was 7.6 in the intervention group. After post-treatment, the mean for placebo group was 7.3, HbA1c 7.3, and in the zinc group it was 6.6. There is a significant reduction in HbA1c level in zinc supplemented group when compared to placebo. The HbA1c level is reduced by 0.98 with zinc supplementation in comparison with placebo, which reduced HbA1c levels by 0.27% with p-value of 0.0036. The difference within treatment groups and HbA1c levels is considered to be statistically significant with p-value of 0.0004. The reduction in HbA1c level was meaningful more in zinc supplementation group compared to the placebo group.
So come to the summary slide now.
Zinc supplementation improved glycemic parameters, HbA1c, fasting blood glucose, and postprandial blood glucose in type 2 DM when compared to the placebo group. Zinc supplementation with the oral hypoglycemic agents may help to attain a better glycemic control. Thanks.
Great. It was an interesting presentation with zinc showing so much of glycemic efficacy for fasting postprandial. A small suggestion, Dr. Himanshu, it was a nice presentation, but you could have made it in a tabular form, in bar graph or so as to make it less complicated and less confusing. Otherwise, it was an interesting study. May I ask, I can see Dr. Bansi, the chairman of DiaCare, he is also keenly listening to all the participants, and that is a very encouraging sign. In spite of being so busy, he is there with you to support this cause. So, Bansi, you want to ask anything? Or thereafter, myself and Dr. Bhagirath can. I think Bansi is busy with something else. Dr. Bhagirath?
Yes, Dr. Tripathi. Would you say something about the zinc overdose or zinc toxicity?
Sir, zinc has been recently associated. There was a study suggesting that cases of mucormycosis might have increased because of the over zinc supplementation during COVID times, because it was helping them in the metabolism to grow. And normally, sir, I haven't seen much zinc toxicity during in my OPD.
So in literature, but you see, it is proposed that probably zinc is one of the responsible thing on which the mucor is also thriving.
Yes,
and that
sir.
Is how the mucor epidemic was driven, supposed to be.
Yes, sir.
But anyway, it is very interesting finding, as Dr. Sanjeev has said, that zinc itself is improving the sugar control, both fasting, PPBS and HbA1c. We don't know about the glycemic variability, but hopefully it would also be tested in future.
Thanks.
But we need larger studies, because the previous studies, hardly there has been any reduction of more than 0.5%. Here you showed demonstrated even reduction of 1% within 12 weeks. That is more than a DPP-4 inhibitor or an SGLT2 or any anti-diabetic drug for that matter. Very interesting. But what are the vegetarian sources of zinc, by the way, Dr. Himanshu?
Sir, pardon?
What are the vegetarian sources of zinc in our diet? The zinc supplementation may not be feasible for everyone because it is associated with toxicity also. So, are there any vegetarian sources for zinc supplementation so that the person does not develop deficiency?
Sir, in green leafy vegetables, we have this. Sir, whole grain milk products.
Yes, milk. one of the important sources. Yes.
Indeed,
is there any other question, Dr. Bhagirath?
No, sir. We'll move to the next candidate. I mean to the previous, who is waiting, probably.
Yes. Dr. Pradeep Kumar, are you ready now?
Yes, sir. I'm myself ready, sir. Sorry for the delay.
So, good presentation, Dr. Himanshu, an interesting study. We would look for a larger study before we come to any conclusion regarding zinc supplementation. So, it's Dr. Pradeep Kumar.
Is the video visible, sir?
Yes, your slides are visible.
Yes, sir. Dr. Pradeep Kumar from Kirpak. Yes, sir. Good morning to one and all. Today, I'm going to present about a study like diabetes and COVID-associated mucormycosis, which was a cross-section study did in our college, Government Kirpak Medical College. So, shall I proceed, sir?
Yes, you can.
Shall I proceed, sir?
Yes.
Yes, sir.
Yes.
So, the object... Yes, sir. Thank you, sir. The aim of our study is to study the clinical epidemiological profile and the risk factors associated with the COVID-associated mucormycosis in the patients treated in our ward at KMC. So basically, mucormycosis is a clinical radiological suspicion with a visualization of broad branch aseptic fungal hyphae on KYH mount and a microscopy and extrapathological specimen by fungal stains or isolation in fungal culture. So the main objective is to find the association between the COVID-associated mucormycosis and the diabetes and how correlate the severity of the glycemic status in these patients and how far the morbidity and the clinical features have been associated with them. So coming to the introduction part, mucormycosis is a dreadful and the most dangerous COVID complication that we are being encountering now. It is a formidable angioinvasive opportunistic infection in the immunocompromised host. Because in neutropenic patients, malignancy and uncontrolled hyperglycemia, they are more suspective. There are six main types: rhino, orbital, cerebral, pulmonary, disseminated, cutaneous, gastrointestinal, and disseminated form. Out of these, in diabetic, neutropenia, iron overload, malignancy, and organ transplant patients, rhino, orbital, cerebral, ROCM is the most common factor. And diabetes is the most common metabolic disorder that predisposes to them for the severity of COVID and mucormycosis. So in diabetes, along with the COVID, the superinfection of mucormycosis will lead to the adherent and adverse clinical outcome and prolonged hospital stay. So our aim is to study the clinical spectrum of the disease and the diabetic status and their outcomes of it. So first of all, we defined what is the disease and the operation definition, and then we proceeded with it. Study setting, this is a descriptive study at the COVID ward in Government Kirpak Medical College. And we studied the patients from April to August 10, 2021. So all lab diagnosed COVID-19 cases were confirmed by RT-PCR, that is a real-time transcription chain method, either by nasopharyngeal and throat swab admitted in our college. Next, the severe COVID-19 cases were defined as the saturation clinically by less than 90%, respiratory tachypneic more than 30 per minute at admission during the hospital stay. Post-COVID cases were defined as the who were clinical recovery from the clinical symptoms or had passed 4 weeks or 28 days from the onset of COVID-19 symptoms. In the lab diagnosis, lymphocytopenia is like absolute lymphocyte count less than 1,000 per millimeter. Data was compiled in the Excel sheets using the software, SSPS software, and the epidemiological and investigation analysis were done and compiled using quantitative variables as well as frequencies with percentage and qualitative data. The association was studied using T-SPAR test. So the risk factors, coming to the risk factors, we studied that in COVID-associated mucormycosis, 87.5% of people had diabetic as the most frequent comorbidity. In diabetic, the mean glucose level was fluctuating around 240, with the mean glycated hemoglobin was around HbA1c 9.06. Shall I proceed, sir?
Yes.
Hello, sir. Yes, sir. So in this, there were no DKA were being seen. And the majority of patients, like 93%, has the steroid exposure either in the form of DEXA or methylprednisolone. So the duration and the amount of exposure could not be determined as it is varied person to person and due to the intake of over-the-counter steroid by the patients, over-steroid intake by the patients. None of our patients had anti-interleukin-6 therapy or monoclonal antibodies, and there were no cases of malignancy, organ transplant, or HIV-AIDS in our study. So the diabetic is the more frequent risk factor in MUCAR in COVID that we have found out. And the steroid exposure have been noted to be significant around 93%. Clinical presentation, out of 93 people, 93% people had headache, followed by nasal symptoms like, yes sir, nasal symptoms in the form of rhinorrhea and nasal stuffiness. And shall I proceed, sir?
Yes, you can proceed.
Yes,
you
sir. 59% had symptoms of red eyes or eye pain. And admission, 56% had history or presented with severe COVID-19 symptoms. And during the diagnosis of COVID-associated MUCAR, 68% had hypoxemia and they required supplemental oxygen, either in the form of CO2 or staff. The duration of the stay was around like was in severe duration in the mean of 11.76. In patients COVID-associated MUCAR mucosis, none of them were fully vaccinated against the COVID-19. Some two patients have received the COVID shield dose, but both of them admitted at center and both of them are on antifungal therapy. Lab investigations, during the admissions, 75% of people had lymphocyte count of 954, that is the mean value of around 769. And we proceeded with CECT or histopathological investigation and microbiological investigation. CECT or MRI paranasal sinuses revealed that 59% had orbital involvement. And maxillin and ethmoid were the predominant involvement in our cases. Some patients had cavernous sinus thrombosis with ophthalmoplegia with cutaneous mucormycosis. There were no patients with cerebral pulmonary or disseminated. And mucormycosis is confirmed by microscopy and histopathology. And the patients were studied and the risk factors were analyzed. And what we have given is liposomal amphotericin B we have given with glycemic control on suspicious patients followed by endoscopic debridement. Endoscopic debridement we used to do in our college and some cases with MMC. And endoscopic debridement 65% is successful and 36 did not survive and 26% is discharged and rest are in parental antifungals. So treatment outcome, liposomal amphotericin B had good with glycemic control and clinical suspicions and followed by endoscopic debridement. 30% of patient endoscopic debridement was done. One patient died before surgery while other denied the surgery. During the entire study, 12% did not survive, but 15% were discharged and rest were on antifungals. So what we have found as a result, like 36 of COVID-associated mucormycosis is an incident of 3.9% and 84% had the diabetic as the most common abnormality with a poor glycemic control of 8.06%. And 80% had higher dose of steroid exposure and surgical debridement for 65% of patients. Some 36% did not survive. So what we have concluded is mucormycosis is the highest angioinvasive fungal study with high mortality. And because the disease has surged in COVID pandemic due to the uncontrolled sugars and improper steroid use, uncontrolled sugars, it favors the replication and improper steroid use. It also induces a cytokine storm. In uncontrolled sugars, it induces cytokine storm and mucormycosis is most favorable to occur in these conditions. Thank you.
Thank you. A very good presentation in spite of presenting it through your mobile and some technical problems. I must congratulate you, Dr. Pradeep Kumar.
Sorry for the interruption.
No need to apologize. Some of the things are beyond our control, especially the technical things. But a very important study and a very honest admission about the mortality. And Dr. Bhagirath might have seen several cases working at BJ Medical College and Civil Hospital. So would you like to have any question, Dr. Solanki?
Dr. Pradeep, what do you think?
Yes, sir.
Their glycemic control was post-COVID discharge. On what kind of drugs they were? They were on insulin or they were on oral hypoglycemics or metformin or whatever?
We usually prescribe insulin for them, sir.
No, and, I'm not talking after the diagnosis.
Kumar, but can you make your video on now so that we can see you if it's possible?
Mm-hmm. Yes.
The question is when they were discharged after the COVID and they came back after the suspicion and of the MUCAR. So what kind of medication they were receiving for control of diabetes along with the steroids?
So we basically give an injection insulin, but if some patient had complaints, then we go for OHAs. Like if they cannot put insulin at home, like some patients, basically we usually recommend insulin. Due to non-compliant patients, we will be giving OHAs like metformin and glyphosate, what's available in setup.
Do you think then when this COVID patient went discharged, when they were meeting the discharge criteria, and were put on the steroids for a longer period according to the physician's judgment, should they be put on the insulin rather than OHA? Do you think so? That was one of the factor for driving the mucor?
The uncontrolled hyperglycemia usually favors by introducing the cytokine storm and reducing the inflammatory markers, interleukin and all these things. But we usually prescribe injection insulin for the management of sugars in COVID. That's what we did, sir.
Sanjeev, sir, any other question you want to ask?
Because in insulin, decreased resistance in already patients with COVID. So we usually prescribe injection human insulin for the better management of COVID, sir. COVID-associated diabetes. Already because of the decreased insulin resistance and decreased dysregulation and cytokine storm, because of the decreased insulin resistance, they are more prone for hyperglycemics, and we usually prescribe insulin than OHAs. And DPP-4 inhibitors is more preferred in OHAs.
Well, the thing is that, do you have any data of the patients where they control with the insulin or they were controlled with the other OHAs? At the time of diagnosis of the mucor or suspicion of mucor, what kind of sugar control drugs they were receiving?
Most of the patients usually come with OHA. Yes, sir.
So were they
when we start the treatment, we
OHA plus insulin.
Yes, sir. Like the drugs they usually take, like metformin, glipizide, it's what the patients usually take. But when we manage in our wards, we usually switch over to human insulin.
All right.
So
can we move on to the next presentation? Congratulations, Dr. Pradeep Kumar. A very important study in the COVID pandemic, because we saw a lot of mucormycosis patients and with very high mortality, as you rightly pointed out. So we can move on to the next presenter, and that is Vidyulata Ashok. And the presentation will be on the prevalence and impact of stress among individuals with type 2 diabetes attending a tertiary diabetes care center in South India. Dr. Vidyulata Ashok. Your time will start once you start presenting the slides.
Good morning, everyone. I hope everyone can hear me.
Yes, you are audible.
Yeah.
And your slides are on the screen.
Yeah. My topic for today is prevalence and impact of stress among individuals with type 2 diabetes attending a tertiary diabetes center in South India. Background of the study, diabetes is associated with increased risk of depression, anxiety, and stress due to its debilitating nature and complications. Stress has an adverse effect on glycemic control due to activation of the hypothalamic pituitary adrenal axis, as well as increase in unhealthy behaviors. Now, the Dawn study has shown that about 41% of individuals with diabetes have severe psychological distress, of which only 10% receive appropriate care. Rationale for the study: the relationship between diabetes and stress is bidirectional, as the chronic nature of diabetes leads to stress, while stress itself could disrupt metabolic control. Assessment of stress in the diabetes population could help fill the lacuna between clinical and psychosocial aspects of diabetes management. Objective of my study: to study the prevalence and impact of stress among individuals with type 2 diabetes mellitus attending a tertiary diabetes care center in Chennai, South India. The methods that we used: this is a cross-sectional case control study, including 300 cases with type 2 DM and 300 with normal glucose tolerance who served as the controls. Assessment of stress was done using a validated tool, the Depression Anxiety Stress Scale 21, of which we used only the stress component. Social demographic characteristics, anthropometry, blood pressure, and biochemical parameters were collected in all the participants. Statistical analysis was done using SPSS 23. Continuous variables were expressed as mean plus or minus standard deviation, and categorical variables expressed as frequencies and percentages. Pearson chi-square test was used to compare frequencies, and regression analysis was used to predict outcomes. P-value of less than 0.05 was considered significant. These are the results. So first we present the mean stress scores based on the questionnaire for the normal glucose tolerance and type 2 diabetes. So you can see a marked trend here where individuals with type 2 DM show a mean stress score of 15 compared to NGT, who are only 7. Now, similarly, the prevalence of stress in individuals with diabetes were much higher. It's almost threefold, as you can see. NGT is 13% compared to 43% in type 2 DM. So these are the biochemical and clinical characteristics of the study population. We found that in type 2 DM, individuals with stress, they showed a higher BMI, and their age also was much lower than the older age group. Similarly, HDL cholesterol also was much higher in the individuals with stress. As far as NGT goes, the 2-hour post-glucose plasma glucose was much higher in the individuals with stress. Now we come to the prevalence of stress based on socio-demographic characteristics. So one by one, I will show you education, income, as well as profession. So here also we see a marked trend, whether they were non-graduates or graduates, individuals with type 2 diabetes showed a much higher stress prevalence compared to the non-graduates. This is the prevalence of stress based on occupation. Here also professionals showed a much higher stress levels compared to the skilled and semi-skilled, as well as the unemployed. Prevalence of stress based on income. So individuals with higher income showed much higher stress levels than those who have a lower stress income. But regardless of all three variables, individuals with type 2 diabetes showed a much higher stress level, be it income, education, or occupation. Coming to type 2 DM, I would like to show you the age-wise prevalence of stress in type 2 diabetes. So here also, interestingly, we found that those in the younger age group, that is the 20 to 39 years, showed a much higher stress prevalence of 45% compared to those over 60 years, who was only 14%. I would like to show you the stress scores based on age at onset of diabetes. So here also, interestingly, we found that the younger age group, the individuals whose diabetes were diagnosed before 25 years, showed a mean stress score of 16.6 compared to those whose diabetes was diagnosed after 41 years, where the mean stress score is only 12.7. So we did a multiple logistic regression using stress as a dependent variable and type 2 diabetes as an independent variable. Here also we found that stress was associated with type 2 DM, where unadjusted, they were 5.1 times more likely to be under stress compared to NGT. Even after adjusting for age, BMI, gender, education, occupation, and income, individuals with type 2 DM were 4.7 times more likely to be under stress. My conclusion: overall prevalence of stress in type 2 DM was 43%. Stress levels were higher in individuals with higher income and professionals, both among type 2 DM and NGT. No significant difference was found based on mode of treatment and duration of DM. Lastly, I would like to say that as individuals with diabetes report high stress levels, collaborative care between diabetologists and consultant psychologists could lead to much better control of diabetes. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Dr. Vidyulata, first for finishing in time and a very precise presentation and interesting one as well. Stress, we know, is a very important risk factor for diabetes as well as the metabolic syndrome as well as the cardiovascular disease. Yes. Very difficult to quantify the stress, and you cannot have a placebo control trial where in one group you give stress, the other group you don't give stress. My question to you is, as you rightly said, that probably we are buying stress by being educated, by being in high income category, or by being a professional.
Yes.
But the ASCVD and the QRIS score, where they have quantified stress as a, rather the financial status as a positive factor for reduction of the stress. So how do you, what do you want to have comment on that?
So the only thing would be that in order to, you know, the individuals with stress and without stress, I mean, with a higher income, the levels of stress or the criteria for stress may be very different. So, you know, they may be, have a set, may be setting very high bars, whereas those in a lower income group, they have much lower standards. They would be putting their children in a corporation school. So they have no kind of stress like that. Whereas those in the higher income group, they aim very high. So that would, you know, put them under more stress.
Correct. Dr. Bhagirath?
Yes. This is again a philosophical discussion that aiming high should invite the stress. So one should not aim high, because our proverb says that you aim high and at least you will get something at least lesser than that also, you will be near to your goal. So, yes, you have a very nice presentation and eye-opener that stress is one of the important factors, irrespective of age, gender, and occupation. But the income and the professionalism, that is mattering. That is a thing to further study. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Thank you.
So then can we move on to the next presentation, and that is again by Dr. Sanyal, and he'll be speaking on fibrocalculus pancreatic diabetes with thyroid aplasia, an unusual case. Dr. Sanyal, your time starts now once you start presenting. Dr. Vidyulata, you will have to stop presenting that.
Dr. Sanyal, can you hear us? Please share your PowerPoint presentation and turn on your video.
Is there any technical problem at Sanyal's end?
Yes, sir. We are trying to call him and he is joining. Sir, we can take Dr. Abhijit Sahar's presentation.
Yes, that's okay. So then, may I request Dr. Abhijit Saha?
Yes, sir.
Ready with your presentation on lipoprotein small a levels in newly diagnosed treatment-naive diabetic patients and its correlation with glycemic and lipid parameters. A very interesting study, it looks like. Dr. Abhijit?
Yes, sir. Sir, is my slides are visible?
Yes, absolutely. Very well visible.
Well, good morning, everybody. Thanks, organizer, for giving me this opportunity. Today, the title of my presentation is Lipoprotein A Levels in Newly Diagnosed Treatment-Naive Type 2 Diabetics and its correlation with the glycemic and lipid parameters. To introduce the molecule was first discovered by the Kerry Berg in 1963. And it has recently been emerged as an independent risk factor for CVDs and most common, and ladies and gentlemen, you will be surprised to know, it is the most common genetic lipoprotein disorder, and FH, that is the familial hypercholesterolemia, is the second common. And more commonly cited cutoff value is below 30 milligram percent, and any value above it in places individual at higher risk of developing CV events, and the risk multiplies further in presence of concomitant lipid and thrombogenic risk factors. And its level are highly variable in humans and under strict genetic control. And the traditional lipid-lowering agents that currently we have generally do not have any effect on its level. This is the structure. It consists of one LDL particle attaches with the disulfide bond with the ApoA moiety. And ApoA has multiple projections on its surface. These are called Pringles. The number of Pringles can vary. And it has got structural resemblance with the plasminogen as shown in the right lower corner of the picture, the structure of plasminogen. And both are structurally similar. And thus it competes with the plasminogen for its activation, thus it inhibits plasminogen activation, and that can lead to the inhibition of the fibrinolysis. Thus, in that way, it promotes thrombosis. And there are limited studies conducted in India, and some of the studies have shown higher values in diabetic population, particularly more in presence of diabetic retinopathy. And with this background knowledge, the current study was done with the following objectives: to look for incidence of elevated LPA levels in type 2 diabetics at the time of diagnosis, and also to find out pattern of lipid profile abnormalities commonly associated with the elevated group of patient, and also to find out its correlation with the glycemic and lipid parameters in treatment-naive type 2 diabetics. It was an observational cross-sectional case control study conducted in Diabetes Clinic of Malda Medical College, and is a tertiary care hospital. And we recruited 70 newly diagnosed treatment-naive type 2 diabetics, and also 50 age and sex matched healthy subjects who served as a controls. And the informed consent and institutional clearance was obtained. And type 2 diabetics who were first time visited our clinic for the initiation of drug therapy, they were included. And also they who were not on any lipid-lowering agents was our inclusion criteria, and all other forms of diabetes and those who presented with acute infection, others metabolic complications or other illnesses were excluded. And also those patients came along with the secondary causes of dyslipidemia, also we did not include them. All participants were underwent a detailed physical examination, and the blood samples were drawn to measure the sugar values, lipid values, and LPA level. LPA level was measured by the sandwich ELISA technique, and thus all data were analyzed by using the ANOVA and the Pearson correlation coefficient. Now the results. Out of 70 newly diagnosed patients, 50 were males, and the mean age of the study population was 46 plus minus 10.95 years. And the mean BMI was calculated in the study population. It was 26.20 plus minus 2.87 kg per meter square. And the fasting, PP sugar, HbA1c, hsCRP, all values are statistically significantly higher in the diabetic study population as compared to controls. These are lipid parameters, and all the parameters of the lipid profile were statistically significantly higher in the diabetic population as compared to controls. So as to the lipoprotein A level, the mean lipoprotein A level measured in the study population was 34.±33.25 mg/cent, whereas it was in control group was measured was 22.87 ± 5.86 mg/cent, and the difference was statistically significant. This is the bar diagram showing 60% of our study population had normal LPA levels, and some around 24% had values between 30 to 50 mg/cent, and 8.5% had values between 51 to 100 mg/cent, and 7.14% had a pretty high value of more than 100 mg/cent, the LPA levels in the study population. These are defined lipid profile abnormalities that we commonly observe in the LPA elevated group of diabetics. The most commonly found pattern was the isolated low HDL cholesterol to the tune of 57% cases, and the combination of high TG and the low HDL cholesterol was found around 39% cases, and only isolated LDL cholesterol was observed in isolated elevated LDL cholesterol was observed in 32% cases. This is the Pearson correlation was calculated between the lipoprotein A and some of the biochemical parameters, and where you can easily see there the 2-hour postprandial sugar, HbA1c and hsCRP were found to be statistically significantly positively correlated with the LPA value, whereas HDL cholesterol was found to be negatively correlated with the significant p-value of 0.04. This is the scatter diagram showing its correlation with the LDL particle, and it was a positive correlation, but it did not attain statistical significance. And this scatter diagram showing its LPA levels correlation with the HDL cholesterol, and it was found to be negative correlation with a significant p-value. That is, with the HDL cholesterol level, there was progressive increase in the LPA level. So now this is the end of my results. This is now the discussion. As I have told, LPA consists of one LDL particle, that is the atherogenic part, and ApoA, it is the ApoA molecule, that is the thrombotic part. And ApoA has got multiple Kringles, and depending upon the number of Kringles, it has different isoforms or exist. The number of Kringles can vary from 3 to 43. And so depending upon its number of Kringles, different ApoA isoforms that exist. And ApoA, as I have alluded for earlier, it is structurally similar to plasminogen. So the different ApoA isoforms are exist, and different ApoA isoforms have different atherogenicity. With this picture clearly showing the lowest size ApoA isoform forming lipoprotein A has got the highest atherogenicity. It is the most lethal for the human being. As you can clearly see the picture, the lowest size ApoA forming lipoprotein A has got the highest atherogenic potentiality. Several studies, recent studies, have postulated its multiple atherogenic and thrombogenic properties. And also, like LDL cholesterol, it is subjected to oxidative modification and become a substrate for uptake by the macrophages, thereby it fueling the formation of the foam cells. And recent studies also suggested that it can retain in the arterial wall to a greater extent than the LDL cholesterol. Our study has certain limitations. We recruited only a modest number of patients, and we did not do the qualitative estimation of the LPA molecule considering ApoA polymorphism. And also, we did not correlate the high value with the CV events. So I conclude, our study demonstrated type 2 diabetes had statistically significant higher levels of lipoprotein A, and the isolated low HDL cholesterol was most commonly observed lipid profile abnormality among the LPA elevated group of diabetics, and lipoprotein A level was negatively correlated with the HDL cholesterol, and probably the residual risk, lipid risk, probably contributed largely by this molecule, lipoprotein A. So the every diabetic should have checked their level at least once in a lifetime to predict their future CV risk, and lipoprotein A level measurement should be incorporated in the traditional lipid profile parameters. And the impact of its this molecule in the type 2 diabetics needs to be further investigated by the prospective studies with the assessment of the ApoA polymorphism. Thanks for the patient hearing. Thank you.
Excellent presentation, Dr. Avijit Saab. Very relevant also, because lipoprotein small a probably has been the underutilized marker both in type 2 diabetics as well as non-diabetics. Though the modification of lipoprotein small a, whether it will have influence on reducing the CV risk or not, is still yet to be proven in large trial. But yes, for our Indian patients, it is very important. Your presentation was Absolutely relevant and very appropriate also. So may I request Dr. Bhagirath to have any questions, is he? Dr. Bhagirath, are you there?
Okay. I'm here. Is there any ways and means to modify the lipoprotein A by any drug, exercise, or any other intervention?
Yes, sir. Basically, sir, I have told that the traditional lipid lowering agents that we use generally do not have its effects on LPA level, but some dietary supplementation, that is some vitamin B3, that is niacin, with high doses, the tune of 3 grams per day, has shown in the studies reduce the LPA level. And also the combination of ascorbic acid, 3 grams per day, with the L-lysine and the L-carnitine, the higher doses can have shown in the studies reduce its level. And some saturated fat intake, some interesting theory has come up. Saturated fat intake can decrease its level. So this is the so far knowledge in the literature about the
molecule. Not even the PCSK9.
Yes, sir. PCSK9, yes, sir. And the recent trial, Fourier trial and Odyssey trial, have demonstrated with the use of PCSK9 inhibitors, it can reduce the LPA level to the tune of 25% to 30%. That's yes, sir.
But also, like we said, Dr. Sanjeev sir already added that reducing this, whether will translate into any benefit or not.
Yes, sir.
Only further studies are required.
Yes, sir. Yes.
But for reducing residual risk, obviously LPA is going to play a major role. That's what most of the scientists predict, especially for our Indian patients. A lot of work has been done in Indians staying outside India.
Yes, sir.
So are you aware about any of such studies? Can you quote anyone?
So I know Fourier study and Odyssey trial, but the Indian study, Indians staying abroad. No, but could not remember.
That's fine. That's okay. You can refer to some NSNS studies.
NSNS, yeah. Yes. Okay. From Kerala.
Yes, from Canada and Kerala.
Hmm.
But a very nice presentation, very relevant too. Can we move on to the next presentation? And is Dr. Sanyal ready now? Or we can move to Dr. Ekta. Pankti, is Dr. Sanyal ready?
He is logged in Zoom, but he is not here. So can we go with Dr. Ekta?
We can go to Dr. Ekta, yes.
Good morning, everyone. Is it audible?
Yes, you are audible.
Just a minute, I'm sharing my presentation. Are slides visible?
Not visible.
I've shared my presentation.
Ma'am, can you please reshare your slides?
Is it visible now?
No, not yet visible.
Yes, Dr. Ekta, we can see your slides. Just unmute your lines and put the slides on a slideshow mode.
Okay. good morning, everyone. This is Ekta Adam here, and basically I'm a pharmacy student. I'm pursuing my PhD from Nirma University. And so my today's topic of presentation would be the tyrosine kinase inhibitor in combination with PPAR gamma agonist, which will direct the metabolic of MPK. So, is it visible and audible as well? Can I just?
Yes, ma'am, your slides are visible. Please go ahead.
The meeting. I don't know whether this is technical error or something.
Ma'am, your voice is breaking. Can you please reshare your slides?
Because I think so. I have been left out from the meeting. So basically, tyrosine kinase inhibitor. So they are the set of drugs which are used.
Sorry for the interruption, Dr. Ekta. We can't see your slides. Can you please reshare it?
It's visible in my PC. I don't know.
Panti, can we ask to Palash Kumar if this Sanyal, Dr. Palash Kumar Sanyal.
Dr. Palash Kumar Sanyal, are you ready?
I think meanwhile, Dr. Ekta can present without slides in that case. Because we are already running late. By 10, we have to finish. Okay, Dr. Palash. So I think it's taking too long to fix this issue, Pankti. Both the speakers.
Sir, we have asked Dr. Ekta to give us the slide. We will present the slides, and Dr. Ekta will present. We will flash the slides.
Okay.
Meanwhile, if Dr. Palash is ready, he can present. Dr. Palash?
We have very limited time left now. We are already running very late.
It's already 10. Sanjeev, sir.
Yes, yes. Actually, I have to join some other a web meeting at 10. Yeah. Just a small suggestion that from now onwards, if there are just 7 minutes presentation, it is better to send it to the organizer and present from their end in the subsequent meetings, especially for this.
Sir, can I also suggest something? I would say just like our speaker's presentation, the recorded presentation should be there. Only Q&A, the student, the presenter yes, should stand here.
So that is also a good suggestion. So as to save time.
So recorded presentation would be available and that would be precisely for the stipulated time. And then we will only have a question answer.
Sorry for the interruption. I have shared my presentation with Pankti. So she'll be sharing my presentation.
Yes, ma'am. Just a second.
So, can I start?
Yes, you can.
Yes, sir, you can.
Yes. So, basically, I'm a pharma student. I'm not from the medical field. So, I have completed my M.Pharm from Nirmal University and I'm pursuing my PhD in the pharmacology and I'm working on the diabetes and the anti-cancer agents. So my PhD project would also revolve around the TKI in diabetes. The role of TKI in diabetes, TKIs, they are usually the tyrosine kinase inhibitors. They are the sets of drugs which are aimed at some specific targets that are active in the tyrosine kinase domain of intracellular receptors. So basically the mechanism of action is to block the chemical changes which are produced in the intracellular spaces of the membrane receptors of the particular target. So when this membrane receptor will receive a signal transduction of the growth, it will imbibe into the nucleus and then it will change the structure of that enzyme and it will be carried out by some enzymatic reaction. So basically our focus was to check whether this TKI have shown some glycemic effect or not. So we have a comparative studies with the PPAR gamma agonist and we aimed to get the synergistic effect in combination with the PPAR gamma agonist and dasatinib, which is a tyrosine kinase molecule. So let me go to the randomization. So before moving that, we have performed the in molecular, like in silico studies. So we have used some software which was available at our Institute Gold to prove the molecular docking studies. So there was, we have found a very good interaction, very good binding efficacy of the PPAR gamma molecules with the TKIs. Then we have thought to perform the in vivo studies. So basically the mechanism was to inhibit the CABL, which was tried to show the expression of increased expression of some proteins, including AMPK. So our major study goal was to evaluate the efficacy of the combination of TKI and PPAR gamma agonist in type 2 diabetes. So the we have selected the DBDB mice, which is the genetic mice model. So they have leptin receptor deficient. So before starting studies, we have taken the basal blood glucose level of this mice. The mice were aged of 6 to 8 weeks and they were of they have found with obesity as well as the diabetes, type 2 diabetes. So we have selected the mice on the basis of the basal glucose level, which was 200 mg or above that. Then we have divided in the different treatment groups. We have kept C57 mice, which is the wild type of this model, as a control group. Then we have DBDB disease control group, vehicle group. And then we have kept our treatment groups, which was dasatinib. One group was treated with the individual dasatinib at the dose of 2.5 mg per kg. The studies were carried out at 4 weeks and we have collected blood samples at different point levels. We have collected the blood glucose level by the tail vein method. We have carried out the blood and we have separated the plasma and serum. And then we have checked the effect of the effect of this treatment on the glucose level. So gallic acid And we have also treated these animals with dasatinib as well as gallic acid. The standard drug was pioglitazone. And then the major treatment group was pioglitazone treated with dasatinib. The dose was 25 mg per kg pio, and the DASA was 2.5 mg per kg. Then we have found the results. Are my slides visible? Pankti, can you move to the result slides? Yes. Yes, there was a significant change in the body weight, but which was more efficiently, which was found in the group of pio plus DASA, which was the combination of PPAR gamma agonist as well as the TKI. Next slide, please. Yes, there was an average. Next slide, please. Yes. There was a maximum decrease of the blood glucose level in the pio plus DASA group. Say, for example, the initial level at the day zero, the blood glucose was 350. Then we have found after the treatment, after 28 days, we have found it up to the 200 or 220. So in a person, overall average, I can say there was a 40% of effect on the blood glucose level. Next slide. Then we have not found any significant changes in the HbA1c, and we have set up a different studies at larger level. We are going to compare the different five kinds of TKI molecule with the newer OHA molecules. So in this study particular, we have not found any significant change in HbA1c as well as insulin. Then we have also conducted an IPGTT test to have a differentiate action of insulin. But we have not found any significant change in the kind of insulin on HUMA IR also. We have found a bit, we cannot say a much significant, but we have found there is an improvement in the triglycerides, which was in the only pioglitazone standard group. Then basically I have performed the Western blot analysis. That was to check the expression of protein level. And in this study, we have found there is an improved and increased expression of AMPK, which was also performed, which was also confirmed by the IHC studies. I have performed IHC studies. The samples of pancreas and liver were taken out, and the whole process of histology and histopathology was carried out. And we have confirmed with the antibodies of the AMPK, there was a specific increase in the group of pioglitazone plus dasatinib. So we can confirm that the synergistic effect of the PPAR gamma agonist and the tyrosine kinase inhibitor, they have shown much increased level of AMPK. And the major correlated pathway is the dasatinib. It is the co-activator of AMPK. In PPAR gamma agonist, they activate or they act through the AMPK mechanism. So here are the samples of the Pankti, can you please move to the histopathological evaluation? We can see that there is a reservation of normal cellular architecture in the treatment group, which is in dasatinib and the combinatory group, where we can see in the normal disease control mice, DBDB mice, they have ruptured the normal cellular architecture. And we can see that
Dr. Ekta, you have just half a minute left.
Yes. So we can see here there is an increased expression of the AMPK in dasatinib and combinatory group. So let me conclude. We can confirm that there is some pathway or mechanism by which we can say that tyrosine kinase inhibitor molecule, they have shown a confirmed decrease in the blood glucose level in diabetic mice. So we have set up a different kind of studies at larger level. There we are going to compare the different molecules of TKI. And there are several clinical studies which are going on at the University of California, San Francisco. They are confirming that imatinib, they have also confirmed preclinical as well as clinical studies. The patient, those who are suffering from CML and those who are on imatinib, they have stopped their insulin as well as oral hypoglycemia.
You can sum up.
Yes. I'm done with my conclusion.
All right. Dr. Bhagirath, do you have any question?
Sir, it is a very preclinical study and giving us the insight about the future use of TKIs. There is tyrosine kinase inhibitors, and there are many molecules of that. Of late, as a physician, we have some experience of using such TKI during the COVID time, but it is not a very large experience. I think hopefully the study would have a bigger impact in the future management of diabetes.
Yes,
great. It was a very important presentation, Dr. Ekta. Unfortunately, because of this technical problems, we could not see your full presentation. But my suggestion would be keep it very brief. You had, I think, more than 50 slides for a 7-minute presentation. This is my suggestion. Just keep 15-20 slides so that it becomes easier for the presenter also and the listeners also.
Yes, sir. Actually, the study was a larger, like...
Yes. It's an important study and a clinical one. And we congratulate you for that.
Yes.
All the presenters were up to the mark. Unfortunately, we cannot include the second presentation by Dr. Sanyal for the paucity of time. It's over to you, Panti, the organizers. And we'll declare the results soon after the evaluation sheet is complete.